Well, good morning, everyone. Good to see you this morning. A little dreary out there, but hey, inside it's nice and sunny. So we're thankful for that. We're thankful for God's Son, Jesus, right? So we're going to do our medley that we've done in the past before. Words will be on the screen, but I don't think you're going to need them. So if you sing along, see those masks blowing in and out, let's get her going, all right?
Baby, all the blue.
make that trip.
Amen.
Yeah. You can be seated. Yeah. Thanks for singing out. That's a fun song. Where's our drummer out, though? So sometimes you got to watch out. Might have some flying sticks. Now, we're good to see y'all this morning. If you're watching on Facebook, on the internet, or whatever, thank you for watching as well. We pray that you join in with us and sing. And we hope everyone's doing well and staying safe. And if there's a few that's under the weather, dealing with sickness or whatever, we pray for you this morning as well. This next song, Power in the Blood.
Would you be free from your burden of sin?
Good morning. It's good to be back. Patsy and I got out of our 4.5 year quarantine, and we've survived the COVID. We're all passed it over clear, so we should be good to go for a while. So the Lord was good to us. You know, I was thinking about it with everything that was going on and everything you see on the news and the pandemic and just lots of things going on, and it's a time it's kind of depressing. And so I went back to what helps me when I go through some rough times. It's got me through pretty much all of them. And it's the 23rd Psalm. You all know it probably from memory. I'm going to do the King James Version, the one I memorized when I was probably 10 or 11 years old in Sunday school. And the one that really sticks with me, and even though I know it by heart, I wanted it in front of me because sometimes I get a little nervous, so I didn't want to forget something. But if we really think about this psalm, it really can do a lot for you when things are kind of rough. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And here's where I really hit home. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The verse going through the valley of the shadow of death, I think when times get rough, that's the one I just play over and over in my mind, because it will get you through the darkest of times to know that you've got someone with you that cares for you, that loves you, that died for you, that'll take you to heaven. So what is there to fear? I mean, if we leave this planet and go to heaven, so be it. It'll just be that much better. But at the same time, it gives you the strength to get through day to day. So with that, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for everything you've done for us. And during these times, it's tough for a lot of people and concerning and depressing. Let us never forget that you're right there with us and that you're always there to help us through whatever may come our way and give us the strength and give us the knowledge to rely on you and to trust you and to trust your promises. In Jesus' name, amen. Now you may partake of the Lord's Supper, and hopefully you all have your bread and juice. Thank you.
Normally do this, but can I get a hallelujah? Hallelujah. What Gene said just touched my heart. And he's right in so many ways. Won't you pray with me? Lord Jesus, we just thank you for everything, Lord. For everything you've done for us, for everything you've given us. We pray for your protection. And we pray for our families, Lord. We pray we be with our children and our grandkids and keep them safe, Lord. We give back now, Lord, our tithes and offerings to you, Lord. And we pray that you bless them and use them for the goodness of your kingdom. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I woke up this morning and was greeted by the sunrise. A simple meal and enjoyed a moment of peace and stillness. I stepped into my vehicle and joined a million others traveling to work today, and I arrived safely. I spent most of the day at my job, doing the same familiar tasks that greet me every day. The work that provides for my needs. I took a walk in the park and received a smile from a stranger. I picked picked up a few groceries. I spoke with my parents. And then I met a friend for coffee. I turned on the radio in my car. I sent a message to someone 1,000 miles away. I washed my clothing. I returned home. A very ordinary day. Everything I've experienced today could be considered unremarkable. They are all profound blessings, the fingerprints of your hand. Help me to grasp the wonder in the small and the simple, to notice the miracles which surround me constantly, to see the beauty in the commonplace and take nothing for granted. Teach me to make gratitude a lifestyle, one which flows into love, rejoicing, and thankfulness every moment that I draw breath. Amen.
It's amazing how two different people can look at life so differently, and how great it is if you have a thankful outlook on life versus an unthankful outlook on life, what a change that can make just day to day. Such a great video. With that in mind, let's pray together and study God's Word. Father, as we come here this morning, we come with hearts that are grateful and thankful to you that we can call upon you as God, the one and only true God. That we can call upon you, Jesus Christ, as our Lord and Savior, the one that died on the cross for us to win victory over death and to give us new life and a righteousness that is found in you alone. Lord, as we study your word this day, I pray for our eyes and our hearts to be open to you, that you continue for us that already know you to transform us in the renewing of our minds, and for those that are still looking for that relationship in you, that they would be receptive, that they would hear, and that they would be open to you, Holy Spirit, in your leading and guiding in their lives. Again, Lord, we're so thankful and grateful. Help us to be thankful. It's in your almighty name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. You know, as I was ending the prayer there, I think about the dad whose son, he came to Jesus and asked Jesus to heal his son. And Jesus asked him if he believed, and you remember what that dad's response was? He says, I believe, but what does he say next? Help me to believe. And, you know, that's not a bad thing for us to say. It's okay to say, I'm thankful. Help me to be thankful. And today, as we look at this message that we're going into, the thought is being thankful with purpose. A lot of you have Thanksgiving plans, I hope, and I don't know how many have been detoured or had changes of plans because of things going on in our country right now, in our world. But whatever the case is, we're still called to be thankful and grateful people. And the premise or our main understanding of that is because we are Christian men and women. And because of that, we're different. We're different in the way we look at things, and the way we're thankful about things is different. And so give you one quick picture of that, and then we'll jump into the study for today. But this last week I was riding with somebody in my car, and they looked over at my mileage for my car, and he said, whoa, you almost got 200,000 miles on this vehicle. And he's like, wow, that's quite a few miles. And I said, well, I'm thankful for it. And I said, I really haven't had much problems, and I really do believe that a lot of the reasons I don't have much troubles with it, because every day I get in that car, I pray over my car. And I thank God for it. And even though there's not a bit of tread left on my tires, I still thank God. And I hope that when the ice comes, I may have to do something. Anyways, I'm still thankful and grateful. And, you know, we've all heard the illustration of the fella that, you know, at work he gets an extra $50 at work that week. and he praises God for that $50, but then he gets a flat tire. And you got the two different guys, and the one guy looks at that situation and says, praise God, I made an extra $50. I can pay for this flat tire this week. And the other man curses God because he says, I made an extra $50, and now I have to spend it on a flat tire. You know, it's that perception, the perspective of things. We've been looking, starting last week, this whole idea of being vocal. And notice we added some pumpkins in there for Thanksgiving this for right now. But with Thanksgiving coming up, how will you be vocal? I know a lot of you may not be meeting the same in person or your dinners and things of that nature, but we still have opportunity to communicate, and we should be purposeful about that communication. The scripture that we've been looking at with this series is this Romans 10, 13 through 14. It says, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord, what's it say? Will be what? Saved. Will be saved because of the truth of who Jesus Christ is. Verse 14 goes on to say, but how can they call on him to save them unless they believe in him? And how can they believe in him if they have never heard about him? And how can they hear about him unless someone tells him or tells them? I want you to just think about that in your own mind for just a moment, that typically most people are not going to come walking into a church building on their own. Say they're pre-Christian, say they've never been in church before, maybe they've been in church some in the past, but they're not just going to come walking into church on their own. How do most people come into church? Word of mouth, or they come with you, or by your personal invitation, or by you picking them up or something, you come alongside them. We need to understand, as we talk about this series of being vocal, that the preacher is not the one that is primarily going to teach or change an individual's lives about Jesus Christ. Who is going to be the person that's going to do that? It's all of you sitting here in this room. God has called upon us to be his hands and feet and to share that gospel message and truth. Now, I look at myself as a pastor and a preacher standing up here this morning. I'm just in the huddle with all of you this morning saying, get out there, keep it up, do your job, tell other people, we've got this, and we can keep going no matter what. And some of you in this room probably remember, you know, I've been a basketball coach over the years, love the sport of basketball, and some of you may remember there was a time I had a group of fifth graders, you know, these boys, and I was down to my final five guys. We had about a minute left. We were down, I think it was either 6 or 8 points. And, you know, the boys come off, and we're having a timeout, and 1 minute left, and one of the kids is in the huddle. He said, Coach, there ain't no way we're going to win this game. And I said, well, go ahead and have a seat on the bench then. They said, what? I said, have a seat on the bench. I'm not going to have people playing on my team or out on the court with that kind of attitude. So I stuck the last four back in for the last minute. And guess what?
We won.
No, we lost. But the premise, the idea, and I can remember the referee going, hey, you only got four guys out here. And I said, that's fine. You know, I wanted to be like one little TV, but nobody was videotaping. But you all understand, I mean, you get it. The reason I did that was because our lives, our attitudes, our mentality is the whole basis of what we're going to do with life. And if we approach life with this attitude of being ungrateful, if we approach this life, even as a Christian, of an attitude of, well, that's somebody else's job, that's somebody else's responsibility, what's going to happen to the kingdom of God? You know, we're going to see those things dwindle, and we're going to see those things being taken away. Let's look at what it says in the Bible. We're going to look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 today. We'll be going just through that chapter, or chapter 2. But the first thing we look at in the first couple of verses is as Paul talks here, is the issue of past experiences. And I think every one of us, we all have past experience, and we all have these things that kind of hold us back or memories in our head. But it says here, you know, brothers, that our visit to you was not a failure. We had previously suffered and been insulted in Philippi, as you know, but with the help of our God, we dared to tell you his gospel in spite of strong opposition. I want you to think about that in your own thoughts and minds. One of the primary reasons I hear of most people not sharing or telling about Jesus Christ more, or telling their brother, their sister, their friend, their coworker about Jesus, is because somewhere along the lines, they've had a time that they told somebody and the reaction was negative. Matter of fact, just 3 days ago, I woke up from a dream where I was telling one of my old high school friends about Jesus, and they said, we were like, hey, you remember who I am? I mean, I was off my age now, and they're like, no, who are you? And I'm like, well, we went to school together. And then this person's like, well, you're that preacher. Always trying to tell people about Jesus, aren't you? She says, I don't believe in that nonsense. And, you know, and I can remember waking up just being distressed. I mean, like my morning, I was just off. I was like, oh, you know, and one, I was irritated. But two, I was like, God, are you telling me that my friend from back in high school doesn't know you as Lord and Savior Jesus? Do I need to call them? Do I need to get on the phone and talk to them? And maybe that is. But the case being, our memories, our thoughts, the things that happen to us so often hold us back or make us fearful or make us leery of doing it again. But we have to. Notice what it says here in these first two verses. He said, in spite of this, we shared the message of Jesus with you. Here's the deal. As a Christian man or woman, if you claim Jesus Christ, we have no option. We are pleaded upon to share the message of Jesus Christ, no matter the consequences. Now, as we jump into the next couple of verses, this should be our approach, the pure motives. Verse 3 and 4. For the appeal we make does not spring from error or impure motives, nor are we trying to trick you. And that's what so often when I've heard people talk about evangelism and things of that nature, I hear people talking about it as kind of like a sales pitch or something. Hey, let me sell you on this. And true, we want to make the gospel attractive and we want to present it in a good way and all that. But it needs to come from pure motive. I'm not here to sell you something. I'm here to give you something. And I come with one that has experienced it myself and one that trusts in it. And there's nothing I'm saying up here in this pulpit that I don't believe in my own heart and I won't do with my own life. On the contrary, we speak as men approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel. We are not trying to please men, but God who tests our hearts. And we all know that in this room probably, but I want you to understand it very clearly this day. No matter what anybody else sitting next to you, no matter what anybody else in this family, in your own personal families, no matter what anyone else thinks, all that my heart and my mind should be to is to God. God, I just want to stand before you as one that is genuine and proven. I want to know that I'm in relationship with you. And, you know, as a man, I grew up very much with a sense of wanting to have my dad's approval. Even as an older man, I would call my dad after I did a project. I would send him pictures of things I did. I would love it when he came to town. I'd take him around town and show him stuff. I'd bring him over here to the church building. We'd look around and talk about things. But I wanted his approval. That's the same mentality that we should have with God. And we should talk in a daily basis with God about, hey, God, when I was talking to that person, thank you for giving me the words. Is there something I need to change? Is there something I can do? You know, that kind of relationship with God. Look it on here to the next verses. Our approach should be one with simple words. How many of you feel like you're very educated, you're ready to tell anybody about Jesus? If anybody comes up to you and asks you, you've got the words, you've got the whole deal down. You guys feel confident about that? Go ahead and raise your hand. You should be confident about that. But, you know, a lot of you would probably say, well, I'm not a preacher, I'm not a teacher. I feel like they might ask a question I might not know the answer to, and all that. When we look at verse 5 and 6, this is exactly what Paul is telling them. It's what it says to us here. You know, we never use flattery, nor do we put on a mask to cover up greed. God is our witness. We were not looking for praise from men, not from you or anyone else. What I want you to hear or to take is to understand this. Just keep it simple. You don't have to be flowery. It doesn't have to be something profound. It's just simply saying, you know what? I believe Jesus is real. I believe he's factual, and he has changed my life. I put all my life in his hands, and he's made a difference. And I don't know about you, but the way things are going in my life, I'm sticking with Jesus Christ. And with all the nonsense we see in our culture right now, I need him. And, you know, I hear people say, well, those Christians, they just believe that, you know, they believe in Jesus because that's a crutch for them. They need something to lean on. Absolutely. I don't want to be leaning on something. I want to be in the hands of God. All right? And I'm not afraid to admit that. Because in our weakness, what's to say? He is strong. Going on. This idea of shared life. In the second part of verse 6 said, as apostles of Christ, we could have been a burden to you, but we were gentle among you like a mother caring for her little children. We loved you so much that we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well, because you had become so dear to us. And here again, what is Paul saying? He's saying simply, hey, we share the message of Jesus with you. We did church together in spite of the opposition, but we did more than that. We shared with you our lives, our feelings, our thoughts, our opinions, who we are. And, you know, that's what we're doing in this house together. We share life together. And we were talking about this earlier in Sunday school class that, you know, sometimes we hear these news reports and something terrible's happened on the news or whatever, and they go around and interview the neighbors. What's the response of the neighbors all the time? Almost 100% of the time, what is the response of the neighbors? Yeah. Oh, he's such a nice guy. I had no idea. I didn't think anything at all. I didn't know anything was going on. Oh, well, you know, and that's always the response. Listen, we share life together, good and bad. And one of the problems that lots of folks have when they come into church is that they don't understand that a church is to be a safe place, a sanctuary, a shelter, where you're able to say, you know what? I do have sin in my life. And I have temptations and struggles, and I need people to pray with me and to hold me accountable to that. One of the things we've seen of the churches over the years is that it seems like the church is a place where if you come in and you say, well, you know what, this last week I fell and I committed this sin. It seems like the church sometimes is a place where you shoot your own. Is that the way it's supposed to be? No, we're not going to sit here and say, hey, that's okay. We're going to say, I understand. And we're going to get through this. But we're going to get on our knees and ask God for forgiveness. And we're going to walk together and get stronger and not do this. Because we are children of the Most High God. That's what we're here for. To share life together and to lift each other up. I don't know how it happened. But somehow, in this church family over the years I've been around here, this church has been a place that has taken preachers, teachers, missionaries that had somewhat fallen out or had issues arise in their lives or whatever it was where they were no longer kind of in the ministry, and we love on them and we care for them. And guess what? They're not here right now with us. Why? Why? Because they're out preaching, teaching, serving as missionaries again. What a great thing. Going on here in verse 9, work hard, be purposeful. And this was the whole idea that we looked at the very beginning with that thanksgiving, is that we're thankful with a purpose. Verse 9 through 12 says, surely you remember, brothers, our toil and hardship. We worked night and day in order not to be a burden to anyone while we preached the gospel of God to you. What was the example Paul and these other apostles and disciples were giving? They were working. They were working hard physically with their own lives in order not to be a burden to the ones they were sharing the gospel with. They were sharing life. They were doing the work. Verse 10, you are witnesses, and so is God, of how holy, righteous, and blameless we were among you who believed. For you know we dealt with each of you as a father deals with his own children, encouraging, comforting, and urging you to live lives worthy of God, who calls you into the kingdom and glory. again, this is a tie-in to what we were talking about in the previous slide, but we together are setting an example, and we do that by working hard, by doing right, and by living righteous lives. What I'm saying about the tie-in to the previous slide was we have problems. I'm not pointing at any specific person, but you all are messed up at times. And you say things out of your mouth sometimes, and it's like, ooh, you best never say that in church, boy. Or you do things in your car sometimes, or, you know, you get frustrated, you respond out of anger, you do things that are inappropriate, and if the measure for us to be in church today was that you had done none of that this week, service would have gotten a lot skimpier, let me tell you, right? But God calls us as Christian brothers and sisters to live a genuine Christian lifestyle. That means we're living lives that are worthy of God and respectful and showing that. So the difference being this, when you're at work and you've had it, and there's one of those moments where you say something that you regret, what's different about us is that we'll go to that person and say, you know what, earlier when I said those things, I was wrong and I shouldn't have. I'm sorry. You know, you don't have to say you're humbling yourselves before them, but you're asking for forgiveness. Because I can tell you, if you're the person on the other side of that, how many of you have ever had somebody come to you at work or on your sports team or whatever group you're in and say something like that to you? What impact will that have on you? You see, when we work, when we go to school, when we go outside this church wall, we're not going outside and saying we're perfect. We're saying our Savior's perfect, and we're putting on His perfection. We're trying to live with Him, through Him, and show that to other people. So, whatever's going on, these things I encourage to you is this, that we share life together, that we're real, that we're willing to communicate with other people in our church family and say, hey, listen, I'm dealing with this problem. Can you be in prayer with me? Can you help me? Can you lift me up? That's real. And I tell you, some of the greatest moments I've had in ministry is when I have people that look at me every Sunday, that step into my office or call me or Facebook message or something and say, hey, Randy, I'm dealing with this problem. I guarantee you, and I can tell you personally, as a pastor and a preacher, I don't look at a person like that and go, oh, well, goodness sakes. I look at a person like that and say, now there's strength, because they were willing to admit that there was something going on. That's a start of healing for anybody, to have that strength to admit the problem. Look it on here. This is the awesome verse. They're all awesome, but this is the awesome, awesome one for me today, because look what it says. And we also thank God continually, because when you receive the word of God, which you heard from us, what's it say next? You accepted it not as the word of men, but as it actually is the word of God, which is at work in you who believe. Now, the reason I think that's so awesome, is because when you read that, that's our power. And I think this is where somewhere the disconnect in churches over the decades has come along. I think there used to be a lot better connection in the past, and we need to reunite or reconnect here. But when you have a power issue, what happens? So last night, I spent an hour late at night because I was trying to be a loving husband. My wife's been complaining about the ceiling fan that she broke, that I need to fix it. She ripped a chain out of the fan speed controller thing. So I bought one switch, got the wrong switch, tried to fix it a few weeks ago. Then I got another switch, and last night I'm trying to fix that. Well, guess what? I got the wrong switch again. It was a 3-wire one. This is a 4-wire one. So I'm trying to take the load wire and figure out how to wire so I can still control the three. Well, maybe one of you smarter about that than I am, but I couldn't figure it out. After an hour, I didn't figure it out. Here's the thing. What's Mandy look at and see with that? It don't work, okay? And you need to still fix it, right? Which I did order the part last night, and it's supposed to be here in 2 days with Amazon Prime. So, things may be still okay in our house. But here's the whole picture of that. Without the power, without that source, it's not going to work right. What's the message to you and I? You see, somewhere along the lines, a disconnect has come where lots of us think, well, by my own wit, by my own cleverness, by my own understanding of the Bible, by my own attendance of church, by my own things, I'm going to try to tell my friend about Jesus Christ. Listen, that's a point of fear. That's a point of feeling unconfident. All those kind of things are going to weigh over you. But when you understand, I'm not sharing Jesus because of something I'm clever about. I'm sharing Jesus because of the power of the Most High God, the living Word, Jesus Christ, the Lord of this world, the Lord of this universe. It's by His power. Then, well, I'm just merely a vessel. So when I say Jesus, the name of Jesus, their power. So no matter how I present it, I'm going to try to do it the best I can. Say it simple, and say it in the power and authority of the Most High God. We look in the last couple of verses here, verse 14, and then we're going to read just the last part of this section of Scripture in the next slide. But listen to what it says in 14. For you, brothers, became imitators of God's churches in Judea, which are in Christ Jesus. And Paul's kind of using this as a picture. You all, you took the example that the other churches were setting for you, and you're doing the same thing. Keep up the good work. You got it. Keep going. You can do this. The point being that I have up here about we stand with thousands upon thousands of churches. And this last week, I literally was trying to figure out how many Protestant churches are there in the world? How many churches of Christ are in this world? How many Christians are in this world? The only number I really could figure out was that Christian number, which they say about 1.2 to 3 billion people are Christians, you know, claim Christ or wear that name. That's amazing. You guys know how many people are in this world? We're over the 7 billions, I know that. Yeah, we're at like 7.6 billion, I think, right now. And it goes up like 100, 200, you know, million per year or something. It's crazy. But thinking about that, literally saying that one out of every seven people in this world believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, or we claim that. What I want you to understand is Southwest, you know, sometimes things and the weight of the world and all the things that we talk about in here and stuff, it weighs on us. Sometimes you may even wake up in the morning with it on you, waking up, oh, that friend of mine that needs Jesus. Hopefully y'all are having a lot more prayers like that and or dreams like that as we go through this series, because it's serious. And what we're talking about here is a very serious matter, because I really do believe that if it's one out of seven in the world are believing in Jesus as Lord and Savior, guess what? Six out of every seven are going to spend eternity in hell. And that should do something to us. I couldn't even wish my worst enemy on this earth to spend eternity in hell because of what I know and read of in the Scripture of what hell is. We don't stand alone. We have churches all around this community, this state, this world, that stand together with us in the gospel and the proclamation of that gospel. So keep that in mind always. The last part of what we read here this day, and I'll read that title to you. It may not always be easy, but you are on the right side. So if you come in here and you say, hey, coach, I've got this friend. I just can't reach him. Nothing I can do. I'm going to tell you, get on the bench, man. I ain't got time for that nonsense. I need people that believe in the power of Jesus Christ and going to get out there and proclaim it. So if you're going to tell me that your friend can't receive Jesus Christ, and the scriptures just says, I'd rather you be hot or cold, because if you're lukewarm, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. Same kind of concept. If you're lukewarm, go have a seat on the bench. God's calling us to get in the game, to get in it, to tell people, and to share the power of Jesus Christ. It says, you suffer from your own countrymen, the same thing those churches suffer from the Jews who killed the Lord Jesus and the prophets and also drove us out. Woo, doesn't that sound awesome? They displease God and are hostile to all men in their effort to keep us from speaking to the Gentile so that they may be saved. In this way, they always heap up their sins to the limit. The wrath of God has come upon them at last. And again, there's going to be strife, and there's going to be troubles. And the Bible I'm reading, which I think is the same one you're all reading, may be a different translation, Gene, but KJV, NIV, NASB, NLT, which I read a little bit earlier, whatever version, it's the Bible, it's the Word of God, and we're reading the same Bible. And the Bible I read tells me this: things are probably going to get worse. And the conditions of things are going to get worse. And the proclamation of Jesus Christ is going to become more and more of a contrast to what our world's going to accept. And it's 6 against 1. Where's that number come from? Remember what we were talking about? 1 out of every 7, 1.2 billion, 6 against 1. In my books, bring it on. Because I've got God on my side. I don't care if it's 7.6 billion to 1. We proclaim Jesus. We're on the right team. And you're on the right side. So keep it up. Stay in there. Fight the good fight. Grant. Probably the greatest sporting victory I've ever seen in my life. What was it? Down a little over a minute left in the a minute, 2 minutes down, double digits in score. And guess what? You guys can go back to your original answer earlier. They won the game. We're going to win. And it may look like the odds are all against us, and it may look like our whole families are against us, and it may look like everybody at work hates us because we're in here. But we're going to win. Let me just go through real quick and we'll wrap up here this morning. But first thing we looked at is your past experiences. You cannot let past experience keep you from proclaiming Jesus Christ. Come from a pure motive. We're not trying to sell something. We're trying to give something, the eternal life of Jesus. Simple words. You don't have to be fancy. Every single one of you in this room right now are equipped to do it. To proclaim Jesus. Tell him what he's done for you. Tell him the truth of who he is. Simple. Share life. Be real with people. You know, I don't go around this community saying, hey guys, everything in my life works out. Everything. You know, I go around and I rent houses and stuff, and I tell people I believe in Jesus. I'm a preacher here in town, and everybody just pays on time and never have any problems. Hogwash. Be real. Share life. It's okay. It's okay for things to happen. It's okay to hit a deer on the interstate. Did you hurt him, the deer?
Probably.
Dave. Work hard and purposeful. Have a reason. This Thanksgiving, share Jesus. Be purposeful about it. Don't just say, hey, thanks. We say, thank you, Lord. The big difference. The video we watch, it's an approach of life. We're thankful. I'm thankful to get up in the morning, be able to have a cup of coffee. I'm thankful to be able to take care of some dogs. I'm thankful to do all these things, even when they come with the messes. All right? Be thankful. The Word of God, and this is that Remember the awesome, awesome verse today? It's the power of God. It's not just us. It's not just some black and white words. It's the power of the eternal God. We stand with thousand upon thousand of churches. This morning I had text from about 10 pastors here in town. We got this. We're going to preach today. We get the honor and the privilege of preaching today. I get messages from Africa. We got this. We're preaching today. We're taking back what Satan's stolen. We're restoring the kingdom of God here on earth. We're going to win people to Jesus Christ. Thousands upon thousands of churches. And last, it may not always be easy, but you're on the right side. You're on the right team. You've got this. Get in there and keep it up. I know you may have been fouled. Who cares? Get back in the game. We got a job to do. And at the end of the day, that's all that matters. The circumstances of the day and what I've gone through, the people I've dealt with, all of that, at the end of the day, all that matters is that we're continuing to pray and we're asking Jesus Christ to open the eyes of our brothers and sisters that need him so desperately in their lives. Because someday, I will stand before God and I will give an account for my life. And you will too. And I pray on that day that first and foremost, Jesus Christ says, I know him. And I know that he has been proclaiming the gospel with his life genuinely and authentically. So important. With that in mind, let's pray. Lord God, Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit, praise, honor, and glory be to you. Again, we set our minds and hearts to be thankful for the price that you paid for us, that you were willing to show us grace and willing to pay the price for our sins. Lord, I pray in these men and women that you will rise up in us and that your spirit would be on us and that your spirit would give us strength and courage and power to proclaim such a beautiful gospel truth message of you, Jesus, and the salvation that comes through you alone. Lord, we want to take back what Satan has stolen. We want to restore what's been broken. We want to heal what's been torn. We can only do that through you, Jesus Christ, and through the power that you give. So with that in mind, Lord Jesus, we give you all the praise, glory, and honor here this morning. It's in your almighty name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Would you please stand as we prepare to sing a song of decision.
Altar's open this morning. If you feel the need to pray, you're welcome to come forward and pray. There's something about coming forward and praying. Just keep that in mind.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. Your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. your power and love as we sing, holy, 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 I want to see you.
Each of you to continue to proclaim Jesus Christ. Friends, foes, makes no difference. Just proclaim the message of Jesus. With that reminder, our baptismal is hot and ready all the time. Matter of fact, something you said or was singing there just reminded me. I've got to be up here in a little bit to do a baptism with another church family. We've had that happen in the last couple of months here. Multiple churches been coming to use our baptismal. Amen. And they'll send a message and say, hey, Randy, does your church? And I said, yeah, we're hot and ready. We're hot and ready anytime. Sounds like a commercial, doesn't it? Wouldn't that be good to be known as a church? It's hot and ready. That's the way we're called to be. So keep that in mind. We do have a few prayer requests that are in your bulletins in that separate colorful sheet of paper. Praise Thanksgiving week. We had a praise. Stephanie Main's dad came home from the hospital, which was a great blessing. Aaron Lewis on Wednesday night, Dale's son was in a motorcycle accident with a deer. The deer won. And he broke collarbone, rib, partially collapsed lung. Anyways, he's doing better. They pulled the tube out yesterday in his chest. And hopefully in about 2-3 days, he'll get to come home from the hospital and just let those bones mend. Could have been much worse. Michelle Miner, which is Emma and Becky's niece, she's having surgery December 11th, and it's one of those where they go in and take a rib out. I don't know if they're going to make another. No, I'm just kidding. But anyway, they take a rib out. There's some nerve damage stuff in her shoulder, so they'll be doing that surgery. Tommy had asked us to continue to pray for Destiny, a friend of his over in St. Louis, daughter that was in a severe accident. Any report? Well, that's probably a good thing. So, yeah. And then his nephew is fighting cancer, so we want to continue to keep him in prayer. And I know Adam got back from Saturday, your uncle. So we want to continue to lift up his uncle, I know, and they were praying for travel safety and things of that nature going back and forth to there. We want to continue to lift up to our schools, and we want to lift up to our missionaries that are on spot today, which is Aaron and Sierra. They leave a week from tomorrow. They're taking off in the van, headed to California. They'll be in training there for another 5 to 6 months, and then they head over to Africa. So, and who knows when we'll see him again. So my pray for Mandy especially, but pray for me as well in that. Any other prayer requests before we pray?
Randy, I'd like you to remember Mackenzie, our granddaughter. She has COVID.
I had seen that, yeah. Okay.
She's doing well.
Any other? What was the name again? All right, let's bow in prayer. Father God, we give you the praise, honor, glory. We thank you again for the opportunity and privilege of being able to worship in this house today in the midst, especially of everything going on in our world, to be able to gather and to lift your name high. We're just so thankful for that. We do lift up to you each of these requests today and pray for healing over Aaron in this accident he's been in. We lift up to you, Destiny, and continue to pray for her recovery from her accident. And for this nephew of Tommy's, we pray for your touch upon him. Pray for the truth of you, Jesus, to be in him and for him to know the peace in you. I do pray for healing and strength as well. I lift up to you, Adam's uncle. I pray for that same truth in him, and I pray for your healing on him and just a continued communication between family and the protection and all of them in this situation. We do lift up to you, Mackenzie. Pray for your touch and healing on her from COVID. And thank you for the recovery of ones here in our house that have had that and for bringing them through. I do lift up to you this neighbor's family of Gene, this Greg Smith. I pray that you would just touch him as they just have experienced such a tragic accident and for just your peace on their house. Lord, I do lift up to you our schools and our community. I pray for this Thanksgiving, just that we would be very purposeful about sharing you. And Lord, I do pray over Aaron and Sierra. I pray for their preparations of the move this coming week and for your hand upon them as they go out in the truth of your name, Jesus Christ. And I pray for your protection on them. Again, use us however you see fit as we leave out of here and put your spirit in us to proclaim the gospel message loud and proud. It's in your almighty name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Do have a couple of fast announcements for you. Number one, we've got our service tonight, 5 o'clock. It is a mass-required service. Make sure and invite people to that maybe have not been in a church, even if they're a different family because of things going on. Soup Kitchen Tuesday night. Donation list is on the bulletin board. Bible study will meet this coming Wednesday, 9:30 a.m. Harvest jars are due back next Sunday. Those are those glass jars out there. Throw coins, change, dollars, checks, whatever in those, and then we take those that offering and use it as a blessing offering to mainly family, but just with December, things of that nature. And then, again, to pick top three Christmas songs that you would like to hear at church. There will be the vote, I guess. And right now, O Holy Night and Joy to the World are on top. So you got one you want to throw in there, you better write it down or get your vote in. I think that's it.